Good afternoon. Hello. Am I on?
Hello.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Architectural Association and the Symposium on Le Corbusier. My name is Hinda Sklar. I'm the librarian here, and it's really nice to see so many faces. Before we begin, I just have a few words I'd like to say, some thank yous. Thanks first to Brett Steele, the director of the AA, who could not be here, unfortunately, for his support for this. And I also want to thank the Swiss Cultural Fund in Britain, who provided us with funding help. I particularly want to acknowledge and thank my colleague Edward Bottoms, the AA's archivist, who has done an enormous amount of work for not only the symposium, but the exhibition, which is upstairs. That is almost solely his effort, and he has been absolutely brilliant to work with on all fronts. Now, the day is really cram-packed full. If you look at the schedule, you'll see it's practically second by second. So I'm going to turn the podium over to my colleague, Irena Murray, Dr. Irena Murray from the Royal Institute of British Architects Library. Before I do that, I just have a few very short housekeeping notes. We've got two brief 15-minute breaks. There will be tea and coffee where the coats are. You're welcome to bring your tea or coffee back into the lecture hall. Also in the same room with the tea and coffee, we will be selling the book that has just come out, edited by Dr. Murray and Julian Osley on Le Corbusier in Britain. Absolutely wonderful compilation of articles and essays. The loos are one floor down. If you go out of here and turn right, go down the stairs and turn right again, they're on your left-hand side. Anytime you either want to refill on tea or coffee or you need to get to the loo, just get up and make your way out. I'd like this not to be incredibly rigidly formal. I've also asked presenters to keep to their time allotments, and just so you know, if you hear an absolutely obnoxious noise, I brought along my French tomato timer, and so it will be me indicating that that's to the current speaker, but I'm fairly confident that nobody's going to run screamingly over. Let me turn the microphone over to Dr. Murray. Thank you. Can you help?
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be here today to participate in a symposium which I have unwittingly brought about by coming across this letter that you can see on your screen in the archives of the Corbusier Foundation in Paris some 15 months ago. It is a well-established fact that in November 1947, Bernard Fielden, then chairman of the Architectural Association Student Committee, wrote a letter inviting Le Corbusier to give a lecture at the school during its centenary. The rest, as you say, is history. But as it turned out, there was this earlier letter that I had the good fortune to come across and which eventually led to today's symposium. Its signatories might have been having a cup of coffee in the students' common room and were rounded up to sign, but perhaps some of them will tell us. But there is no mistaking the energy with which they wished Le Corbusier to come. Afin que votre influence puisse se faire sentir et que vos idées puissent être rendues de vive voix, as they put it in their respectable high school French. Subjunctives. 62 years later, some of these very same students are with us to look back at the event and its legacy. This symposium and the exhibition upstairs have been a collaborative project between the Architectural Association and the RIBA Trust, in particular, between its two respective libraries and archives. If the AA took the initiative for the original lecture, the RIBA preserved, thanks to Stephen McFarlane, the original diagrams just as they were about to disappear, literally, into the dustbins of history. And I'm sure that he will be able to comment on what was actually happening. This event is also part of the ambitious Le Corbusier season, in which the RIBA Trust staged the biggest exhibition on Le Corbusier ever shown in Britain, and which is currently on view at the Lutyens Crypt in Liverpool. It is a fantastic setting in which two rivals coexist in a dramatic whole. If you miss it, the exhibition is coming through Barbican in February. Of the thousands of people Corbusier exchanged letters, students were the biggest group. And I think that looking back on my discoveries in the archive, it was the group for which he had the most time. On September 3rd, 1939, the day on which Great Britain declared war on Germany, Stefan Buzas, a 24-year-old student at the Architectural Association, addressed a jubilant note to Monsieur Le Corbusier, his architectural hero, and I quote, "Through a very significant and extraordinary coincidence, I received today a parcel sent from Germany by a friend of mine. Your book, La Ville Radieuse, was in it. This is the first day in my life where I know at last what I'm living for. And this will be the first day towards the realization of your ideals, towards the happiness of mankind." Stephen Buzas unfortunately passed away last month. But we are fortunate to have a number of his AA colleagues with us today and very eager to hear their story. It gives me an extraordinary pleasure to turn the microphone over to number three among the signatories on this letter, distinguished professor of architectural history, Joseph Rykwert, a friend and the mentor, who, by the way, led us to many others on the list. He's going to chair the symposium this afternoon and will take us on a speculative journey of do we still love Le Corbusier? Thank you.
William Curtis, who's sitting next to me, looked over my shoulder just now and said, "Or should we still hate Le Corbusier?" My title obviously is answered by this audience very much in the affirmative. Yes, we should, but certainly at the time when we wrote the letter, it was a letter written by a minority of the students of the AA. I think it was a long time ago, and people may find it difficult to cast back their minds to the time. But from 1944 onwards, a stream of ex-servicemen arrived at the AA in waves, and they were, of course, not terribly interested in problems of theory or style or all those things. They were interested in getting a diploma and starting on a career. So the people who signed this letter were, in a sense, seen as tedious troublemakers, young nobodies who got ideas about their station in life. And maybe there is something to that. We were callow, we were very young, and we thought that Corbusier was the answer to the maiden's prayer in the proverbial terms. We thought that he had the key in the way that other architects of his generation, architects whom he also venerated, and without being quite clear about how very different they were from one from another. We venerated Mies, we venerated Gropius, but above all, and I think those of us who signed the letter, above all, we venerated Corbusier. It was a time when he was beginning on the Unité at Marseille, which at that point in Marseille was known as La Maison du Fada, the madman's house. And when I went there, I a couple of times went to bistro at the foot of the hill, and the lady who ran the bistro said that yes, she did know him. He used to come in there quite a lot and have his lunch, and he never owned up to who he was, but he listened carefully to people talking about Le Fada, who was building this crazy building. And so when, at the end, it became clear who he was and they got wise to it, he was very offhand with them. He was, after all, Le Fada, and he wasn't going to be pacified very easily. But as the building went up, it became more and more respectable. It became the aim of many pilgrimages, and some of us were privileged to go up on the roof and look at the landscape around it, look at the bay, and go through the interior streets, which at that point wasn't very well populated. And it was very striking going back to the Maison du Fada about 3 years ago, when it had been very carefully restored, when the interior street was full of offices and cafes and well populated, when there was a yoga class in the theater and children in the school. But the view from the terrace, from the roof terrace, was obscured by crass high-rise, more or less high-rise blocks of flats which had grown round it and which had none of the social implications. They were straightforward, speculative, commercial blocks. And although most of them were more or less slab blocks, they had none of the intentions or pretensions of Corbusier's Unité, which remains now in its restored state as one of the great buildings of the 20th century. And perhaps it's worth remembering that there are other things about that time that are not often recollected in connection with him. Perhaps the hate, which William has just mentioned, has obscured them. But the thing which I would like to remind people of is his extraordinary sense of context. There was in the small Argentinian town of La Plata a doctor, a medical doctor called Cruchet, who was determined to get the best building by the best architect he possibly could. And he wrote round to a number of people, most of whom didn't answer. But to his great surprise, at a certain point, he received a set of drawings and a model from Corbusier's office. And he was so impressed by this that he determined to build it exactly as Corbusier had drawn it. And it is now in La Plata, you can go and see it. And what is extraordinary about it is that Corbusier, who had never been to La Plata, he'd only been to Buenos Aires, had managed to put that house into a context which he knew only from photographs, with extraordinary skill and delicacy. Not perhaps delicacy, not perhaps a quality you associate with him, But it was very much that that impressed, certainly me as a visitor, the way in which that little house manages to insert itself into a context which, after all, must have been unknown to him. But it was also a time at which he was, in a way, revising, revisiting his views. And by 1950, he was working on the church at Ronchamp, the building which caused a great deal of scandal amongst many of his contemporaries and even his followers, because it seemed to go against what they expected of him, what they had found in Marseille. So, two things I would like to say to begin with. One is his extraordinary ability to adapt himself to an environment into which he wanted to insert a building. The way he did so in Marseille was quite different from the way he did in La Plata. But also, his extraordinary ability to renew himself, to start anew, to rethink the foundations of his, to rethink his, in a way, his assumptions, and to come up with solutions which were both unexpected and breathtakingly poetic. And this is perhaps what is comes up over and over again in his writings, the sense of poetry which was essential to him, and a word which he liked, which he often returned to. And it was the sense which inspired his prose, a prose which is in a way rather alien to the English reader, but which goes back to a French tradition of sermonizing, which is a great stream in French literature. He was always preachy, and I think all the better for it. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Now I'm going to call on Paffard Keatinge-Clay, who was the only one amongst us who actually worked for Corbusier.
Inside, we're going to go inside to inside 35 Rue de Sèvres in Paris. At that, Le Corbusier called it, which is Atelier des Bâtisseurs, a studio of builders. If you don't want the more decorative idea of architecture, in this case it's building, studio of builders. And we're going to go inside. we have no time at all. Berdiansky said, please put everything you're working on aside. We're going to go into a competition now. We've got to work like mad, 4 days, three nights. And we're working on two or three projects and some city planning, but all goes aside. Everybody join in. We're going to work now nonstop, 4 days, three nights, and we're going to win this competition. It's a part of Paris, an area for 5,000 people, and we're going to apply everything we know. We're working on right now in the unity. We've got so much worked out. We've got so much experience. We're going to put it into this project, and it's going to be three times as long as the unity in Marseille. It's going to run diagonally across the landscape. It's going to be way off the ground, and the ground floor is going to be like a snake. It can go in and out way. It touches base, touches the elevator shafts, about three groups of elevator shafts along this project. Very long building, very beautiful. And we have to work like mad because we're going to win this competition. And Wojcicki, you'll be in charge of the interior planning, which we're going to move from the unity exteriors. And Berdiansky is going to resolve the where the exhaust shafts come up and things like that. And Sultan, Jerzy Sultan, is going to work with Le Corbusier on the ground floor because he does the curves beautifully the way Kobu likes it. And Paffard, you help Condylis, and with Condylis you work on the sections and the elevations, and we've got no fooling around, we've got no time. We've got to work like mad. 2 o'clock, Le Corbusier comes into the office, and he'll change the curve. There's no doubt about it at all. So Sultan, go easy, but rough it out. And then 2 o'clock, Le Corbusier comes into the office, and he's very happy that we're all working on it. He's very interested and very excited about the whole thing. And immediately, we make these enormous drawings. We work in shifts at night. And then Le Corbusier comes in, Mollis at the end with his own pen. Jerzy Sultan makes a beautiful curve, so very, very good ink work. And Le Corbusier comes in with a pen, a little bit split nib, a little bit scratchy, splattering, a little bit ink around, drawing the people and the trees and things like that, you know, which he loves, the finishing touch of everything. Goes to the printer, comes back from the printer, very large sheets. We mark them on large sheets of aluminum, and like these two tables together, practically, very big. And then we carry them to the place where they're going to be judged in Paris. We walk through the streets with these large aluminum sheets, and it's so beautiful. We sing. It's like old Beaux-Arts, really. Charrette, they called it in Beaux-Arts. You're still pushing the charrette, and you're working on it in the streets, you know, still we're finishing it before it gets in last moment into the hall where it's going to be judged before the big doors close and so on. But what a fantastic experience. I mean, students, in fact, all students, we're not all students, people like Bodialski, really experienced engineers, but we're all carrying these large sheets of aluminum through the streets of Paris, singing. Nothing could be more wonderful for students, you know, to carry the work of a master, singing through the streets of Paris, huh? Just before the doors close. And then we wait. Wait for 3-4 days while judging is going on. And then we're all excited, we're longing to see at last Le Corbusier's work will be received by governmental authorities without a friendly someone to support the cause as an individual. And we wait till the big doors thrown open again, and we sit around outside waiting for these doors. Everything will be hung, you know that. All entries will be hung. So we'll be able to run in and see them, and certainly ours will win. Certainly going to be first prize. The doors are flung open, we rush in, all excited, all like students. I was a student, so I thought everybody else was. They were not, they were experienced people at all. But we felt like students. We rushed in. The first, number one, absolute banality. Yes, the winning one. Number two, like an imitation of number one, even more banality. Number three, the same banality. And we couldn't see what we put in. About number seven along the line was a project by Pierre Jean-Lopez, who was not very good, really, not very good. A very diluted Le Corbusier, and in a way, probably he didn't have a good staff, so he didn't have it documented really well, but that was hung. But where was Le Corbusier's? Quite simple. It was not hung at all. It was stacked in the back of the room where nobody could even look at it without lifting the panels out one by one. I asked Bodiansky, was Le Corbusier so hated? So heated in Paris? And he said, no. Corbusier loves to enter competitions, but he always violates the rules of the competition. He always rewrites the rules of competition the way they should be written. So he always loses. here he is, and he is, he looks really cool, and he doesn't mind too much. You know, here's just another competition lost. He goes on to the next. He's always on to the next. And he felt like this inside. His inner emotions. he's so used to this. How can I say that? This is a public release, but with his friends, he says always, what you have to do in life is you have to fight the windmills. You've got to fight the windmills. And then he said, you're for a battle of Cotterly Moulin. And I won't speak French, it's horrible, I've forgotten it. The next one is, how to get into Troy. You go inside a wooden horse, and maybe we get him. That could be the United Nations building or something like that. How to get into a government project, except crawling into a horse. And then next one was, yes, except you're going to be beaten up. You're going to be beaten up every time. You should be like a beast of burden. Bon courage! And then without money. Corbo. Corbo. The bird picking away at an empty plate. So I have to go first. You don't have time. We've gone back to work, however. We're back on Green Shade. Here's where I lived. I had a wonderful opportunity. I lived as a Swiss student in the Swiss pavilion when it was way out in the country. So beautiful, so great. And there, the ground floor, just touching on the edge of the structure up above. And there's a relationship that went on every project. The main thing here, this was a kind of prototype for the Unité. People didn't understand that, but working on the working drawings, you can see that very, very clearly. So here we are in Rue de Sèvres, and here's Le Corbusier. If people don't know, it is a monastery, and this is a long corridor, an abandoned corridor, a semi-abandoned monastery. And on the right, the wall on the right there separates it from the church. We could hear the Bach fumes and Gregorian chants and things coming through. But all of our drawing boards, as you see, are lined on the right-hand side there. There are about 12 of us. About of those 12, there will be maybe four stagiaires. That is apprentice type, as I was when I first went in. And on the left, we have the engineers, city planning, but all very narrow. Nothing is done to impress clients. Nothing is done to impress clients. This is work, a workshop, a tablier. And so Le Corbusier would put on the head foot, you can't quite see this, but typically the rules of the game. The rules of the game have the modular. We must conform to the rules of the modular. This was extremely important. I was working on, because I had some engineering background, a kind of transition between the architects and the engineers. So I was, here we are, the modular. And the modular we took very seriously. Bergians? No, Wronski in particular. He saw that everybody would work, every dimension was related to this system. And very, very severe. And here we go, Unité, at the A. Here is the first image. To be very simple, it's not an apartment building. It is a neighborhood unit, because it all functions with a neighborhood in it. And we thought this is the first model we made. And it's very, very simple. The roof is very, very clean. And we thought it all being very white, like Poissy in the landscape. So that was the image for a long time. And then appliance systems was really important. This is what I worked on. Concrete frame inside, and then putting into it a space, which was actually a modular space of clear inside dimensions, which is of wood and steel, and that goes into it. So the frame itself would theoretically receive all types of shapes and things according to three-dimensional shapes, according to two-story, one-story constructs. And then Le Corbusier thought again, once again, what? He can't leave that roof alone. There's no way he's going to leave that roof alone. So the great excitement was the roof terrace. And this was a sculptural thing, going back to his old idea of funnels and things like that. So basically, he would, at the office, in the office, which I just showed you, he would go down the line and visit our drawing boards and sometimes make some comments, sometimes stay a long time, sometimes make some changes, of course. But what infuriated me was that we had to follow all of these rules. Wojcicki was adamant about this. And Le Corbusier, whenever he came to the drawing board, he violated all his own rules. And I wanted to protect Le Corbusier's work from Le Corbusier. And it made him so furious, you know, that he could come and violate his own rules. And I didn't understand it. But he was very abrupt, often rude. Get on with the job. We didn't want any discussions whatsoever in the office. Get on with the job. Really, sometimes very, very rude. But on Saturday mornings, we could come into the office, sit around very, very casually, and talk about anything. He said, we will chat about anything. Saturday morning, about 10 o'clock, we came in, sat around, and then he would tell us the last things that have been happening. Here I saw the show. He came back from New York with the United Nations building. There's not time to go into this. But it was a sad time. It was the last trip back. After it was already all turned over to Rockefeller and Rockefeller's architects and so on. I'm running out of time. Okay, I've got to go faster. Okay, thank you very much. I won't say what Le Corbusier said, but in these mornings you could ask anything of Le Corbusier. That was so wonderful, open and charming. And I asked one question. When can an architect violate rules? When? I didn't ask him in such an arrogant way. But he said, and this is the wonderful, he said, architecture is an art, like any other art, like poetry, or music, or painting. You can violate a rule only, and you repeat it, only when it strengthens the art to do so. And then I need to understand. And so they're picking up from the systems and moving on into the poetic, into the sculptural. I understood that inside. Well, I wanted to say goodbye to Le Corbusier. I was there for 6 months. It was now getting close to Christmas. I was going to come home. But I want to say goodbye to Le Corbusier, thank him for everything that he's taught me. Yes, like a friend, God, all these things together. But he said, no, I've got to go. And he's going to go to the CIAN conference. And we knew when he should go, but he was suddenly gone. And I couldn't say goodbye. And some students had written to him or some stupid thing, you know, so he had to go. And I had to get the work out, and didn't really know too much what was happening, except I knew about the CIAN. And he said, no, I'm sorry, did I say anything? I couldn't say goodbye to him. I asked Sultan, what should I do? Sultan said, Le Corbusier is not the type of person who shake his hands and say thank you very much. That's not the type at all. Thank him in your work. When you become an architect, go back to the RIBA, get your exams, become an architect. When you're an architect, then thank him. Thank him in terms of your own work. Even if it's a small detail, even if it's a pivot to do on. Where it is, this is Los Angeles. Thank him in your work, and that he will love. Even if he is dead, he will love that you thank him by what you learn in your work. This one.
Since Yeja Sultan has come up in the conversation, I should mention something that Paffard did not, that he, of course, broke the rule by being 6'4". And he came out of a prisoner of war camp and arrived at Union Saint-Jean-Colly to see Corbusier in the hope of getting work, which he did, as Paffard said, got. But Corbusier opened the door, looked up at Sultan, and said, Mais Sultan, vous êtes trop grand. But Sultan, you're too tall. And that was the beginning of a long collaboration and friendship. Now, the next speaker is Oliver Cox. Who I don't think I need to introduce because he's well known to all of us.
I was a member of the Students' Committee in 1947, and Bernard Fielden was the chairman, who sadly died just a fortnight ago. But apropos of this meeting today, he had written to me a week or so before, asking that I remembered certain things that he remembered better than I did at that time. And that was that we had written to Corbusier, this was over a year after the letter that you saw on the board, and we invited him only to be told a week later by the council they'd already invited him and the invitation had been turned down. So so Bernard tells me, he dispatched the gentleman that was on the right of the photograph just there, another fellow student, Alan Ballantyne, in Bernard's words, to pray on the doorstep of Le Corbusier, which he did, and Le Corbusier came. And before the lecture, a group of us, I can remember Bernard, Graham Shankland, Michael Ventris, and we all sat down at a table just by that window there, because this was the restaurant at the time, with Corb, and to our amazement, he spoke English to us. According to Paffard, it had been very broken English, but he struggled hard. The lecture, of course, was in fluent French, but he managed English well enough for us to understand. And he got into an argument with Michael Ventris about perspective drawing. Michael had designed a machine called the perspectron, which produced quick perspectives without vanishing points. Corb had no time for that at all. He said, oh no, you see the way I do internal perspectives. And he did demonstrate it with two vanishing points, not one that we normally use. And this gave him, he said, the architect's perception of the scheme, not a mere camera view. And that was, I think, the reason why he drew these drawings at the introduction of his lecture later, in which there is the man at the top with his 60-degree angle, which he contrasted with the stupid idea, c'est faux, he said, of the grande renaissance, as though you had eyes in the back of your head, everything based on an axis. But there is, I think, Michael Ventris's man below him there, with a rather constricted view. C'est miserable. That is the narrow view of the camera, very different from the perception which led off to the lecture. Now, I think I need to say a word just about the nature of the school at that time, because the AA had had a sudden influx in 1946 of all those people who had been deferred from the services up to inter. And so in 1946, the school, back here in London again, suddenly doubled in size with a fourth year, with 100 more students, all at fourth year level. And that was a real mixture between people who were young students of, say, 17, and those of us older students, some of them pre-war students like myself, 20 years, it seemed, only 10 years difference, but it seemed like 20 years, generation gap. They were, these young students were kids to us after what we'd been through. And so those of us who had lived at the AA before the war remembered vividly those heady days and the battles we fought under the banner of Corbusier before the war, and we wanted to pick up where we had left off. And remembering these events, of course Corbusier was the obvious person to invite. Now I want to wind back 11 years before that, when I was a schoolboy and first fell under the influence of Corbusier. My brother, 5 years older, was here and in the middle of an interesting battle, which was to get warmed up during the next few years. And this was at Mill Hill School, and with a great deal of help from the library here and from students, friends of my brother's, we mounted an exhibition which was pure call. It was called How Do You Live? And it was an attempt to confront the somewhat staid parents on Founders Day of this conventional public school with Corb's ideas of the aeroplane and the motor car floated about on the screens, and pictures of Corb's villas and Mises' plans in order to really try to strike a blow for the modern movement in a very conventional school. The following year, when I was at the AA, we were very conscious of a small movement amongst the students who were influenced by the events going on internationally. Siam had been formed with Corb, a founding member. In the UK, we had the Mars Group, Maxwell Fry, very influential in that organization. And Gropius and Breuer were both over here before they went to the States. And so there was an awareness of the modern movement. But it wasn't until the arrival of a temporary principal, E.A.A. Rouse was his name. He electrified the school by suddenly introducing the unit system, in which 15 students were grouped together rather than a year of about what could be in the up to 60 students or so. And in one studio, there would be, say, unit 2, unit 6, and unit 12, all working side by side. This was a very exciting new arrival at the AA. For the first time, the students found someone of enthusiasm on the staff who taught in evening classes, this is the subject, on planning and research for national development. This was heavy stuff to students who'd been really still very much studying the classics. Now, I'd like to quote what my brother wrote some years later about the mood at the time. And this is what he said. We're talking 1936. We had by now got beyond our first exhilarating excitement of discovering the modern movement. We were now part of it. We glimpsed the promise of a brave new world. Corbusier's books had been an illuminated manuscript and a declaration of faith expressed with a lyrical buoyancy that at least the Englishman with half-baked French was full of the hideous stuff of poetry. Nobody I can think of ever painted his New Jerusalem so clearly and provided so many examples. Open any volume of the Oeuvre Complete, and there it was, with the photograph of the staircase leading up to heaven by way of the roof garden. Well, that was my brother writing in 65. Now, as we went back to 36 again, the pantomime of the end of that year proved to be prophetic. And this is what happened at the end of the panto, when after a mock battle, a football fight between the staff and the students, won of course by the students, they came out with this chant. You better unfasten your seatbelts. 1, 2, 3, 4, don't put up with any more. 5, 6, 7, 8, you'll be lost if you hesitate. 9, 10, 11, 12, seize the school and run it yourselves. That's not all. At the end of that, they sang a song, which again shows you the mood of the time. I'll do my best to sing it. My voice is not quite what it was 40 years ago. Here's the reason for our recovery. We've made a great discovery that Corbusier is the only way. Get a new master, get a new man. We are building a new community. Men and women will live in unity. We can guarantee perfect liberty, free love, free plans. Thank you very much. Anyway, why was Corbusier? Why not Gropius, Mies, Mendelssohn, Frank Lloyd Wright? Why was it Corbusier that was such a focus of attention? Now, the architect and building news in the year later wrote the following in answer to that question, and I quote. There were dozens of modernisms 10 years ago, as they were writing in 38. There was the Dessaubrand, cool, calm, and intellectual, the tensely Germanic expressionism of Hamburg, the Einstein term, verticals and horizontals. There was the Perret brothers. Then, in the early 20s, Korb came along with the detachment which only a very great poets are born with. He saw the whole architectural situation, as it were, from the outside. He saw the lunacy of style versus style, modernism versus modernism, architecture versus engineering. He saw the modern world with bits and pieces of modern architecture lying about all over it. He put the pieces together, and every young architect, with a grain of imagination, saw the way he had done it was the right way. Now it's important to see the mood of the AA at the time against the international situation, which was grave. Hitler was on the march, so was Mussolini. There was a Spanish civil war going on. The leadership in this country was very much under question, especially amongst the younger students. And all this gave a political edge to the battles about to commence in the AA. The International Exhibition in Paris of 1937 was an eye-opener and brings the question of art and politics extremely close together. Because after my first sight of my first Korb building in the Pavillon Suisse, we went to the exhibition and were confronted by the stodgy neoclassicism of the German, Italian, and Russian pavilions. Then going to the relatively humble pavilion of the Spanish Republic, we suddenly, like receiving a blow in the face, suddenly were confronted by Picasso's Guernica. This was the situation within which the next AA battles were conducted. Now the first sign of concern by the staff of the activities and interests of the students in relation to the modern movement was the appointment of a distinguished architect, who's president of the RIBA, Goodhart Rendell. And he proceeded to give a lecture on his attitude to architecture, which was very much a traditional view, in which I'll pick out a few points that he raised. He spoke of the irrevocable esquisse in which, believe it or not, student was expected to take on the brief, produce an immediate esquisse, sketch, and then stick to that throughout the whole design process. He was therefore opposed to research and opposed to group working, two things which were felt to be very important by the young students. This was followed by the appointment of a gentleman called Fernand Billery, ex-École des Beaux-Arts, if I can digress just for a moment. 30 years later in Paris, when we saw the events of these événements, we saw those posters with the same words on it, ex-École des Beaux-Arts. Well, that was followed by a riposte from the students, the Yellow Book, in which they put forward a manifesto for their views on education. That was followed then by an inspection by the Board of Education. The Board of Education and the Council together were very concerned about the power of the students to change the education policy through their vote on the council. So the council introduced a special general meeting, and at that meeting the bylaws were changed to remove the student vote. And Summerson, writing in his centenary booklet on history, says, thus, 91 years after its foundation by students, the AA excluded students from the management of its affairs. So it was all not doom and gloom, because without this tremendous attack, really from L'École des Beaux-Arts, we would never have had focus. The atmosphere in the AA at the time was a collegiate one. Everybody worked in the studios, poring over their drawing boards. People lived nearby. There was a house in Bloomsbury Street where the fourth year students were. I shared a garret in Charlotte Street with Howard Clemenson. And in 30 Percy Street, Focus was born. This was the flat in which my brother Tony worked, and he just left the school. And together with Leo Decillis and Tim Bennett, who was an absolute polymath, brilliant young student, they were joined later by Howard Clemenson. They actually were the creators of Focus. And it was first conceived as a counterblast to Goodhart Rendell. It was be a slap in the face to him, open letter by Tony, and then Tim would get Cobb to write his views about teaching of architecture. They did, both were successful, and of course the Focus number one contained these articles. And I conclude with a quotation from Summerson again. And this is the end of my talk, so don't worry, I'm going over time. It is the present custom to regard these series of incidents as a troublesome chapter in our history, now fortunately closed. But a historian must be forgiven for noticing these events and indeed distinguishing them as an instance of student initiative comparable in vitality to that initiative of the 1840s, which resulted in the foundation of the association itself. And to conclude, when he reviewed, Summerson, the 38 exhibition of students' work, he remarked how it was dominated by students following the modern movement. And he wrote as follows. It was strange that the students should be drawn to a minority movement that did not by any means follow the peaks of material or academic success in the outside world. To my mind, there is only one answer, and that is poetic appeal. And the poet is the Ruskin of our age, Le Corbusier.
Good afternoon. I'm a little apprehensive of talking of the AA in the 1940s, when there were so many people here who are rather better qualified by the fact that they're actually there at the time. Indeed, our own archival material from this period is relatively thin, consisting primarily of council minute books and literally only a handful of student projects which have survived through to us today. I will therefore hope to draw together some of the many voices of AA alumni recorded in print or in interviews or from correspondence that we've received recently in connection with this symposium. Indeed, I'd like to try and provide some sense of the context of the AA in 1947 when Corbusier came to give his lecture. 1947 was a year of austerity. It was the year of the big freeze with the heaviest snowfall since 1819. It was the year of the fuel shortage crisis with factories grinding to a halt, transport failures, power cuts, and then... Goodness me.
Remind me later.
See, all sorts of failures. Followed by the most severe flooding in decades in the spring for the south and east of England. Food rationing was still very much in full flow, the average housewife queuing an hour a day for food. And against all this was the acute housing shortage. Nearly 500,000 homes had been destroyed or made uninhabitable during the war, with a further 250,000 having sustained severe damage. For Sir John Summerson, however, engaged in 1947 on his centennial history of the AA, it was a hollow year of poverty, but it was brimming with hope. Indeed, optimism is the note sounded by most AA student and staff recollections. Arthur Korn, in an interview in 1972, remembers the returning servicemen as having a tremendous keenness to get back to work. Although it took them about 3 or 4 weeks before they could begin to draw again, there's this wonderful feeling of, well, now it's all over, let's get down to it and rebuild the world. Similarly, Professor Dennis Hinton, writing to the archive recently, recalls a brave new world atmosphere as permeating the school in those days. All the wartime talk and planning could now be acted upon. Planning legislation was being implemented. The New Towns Act of 1946, the Town and Country Planning Act of 1947. In the words of the AA prospectus for 46-47, this is one of the most vital and exciting periods in the life of the nation as a whole. The great wars are over, and the nation is reorganising for sustained advance rather than for mere reconstruction. However, I want to just go back a little bit to where Oliver Cox left off with the AA Revolution of the 30s. And in 1939, under pressure from the Board of Education, the AA school evacuated Bedford Square. Geoffrey Jellicoe, its then principal, locating and renting Mount House, a Georgian residence off Hadley Common, Barnet. Here the school stayed for the duration of war. Numbers dwindled as the students were called up, the lowest point being reached in January 1941, when there was a total of just 69 students registered. By January 1944, female students outnumbered their male counterparts by 50 to 46. The teaching staff under Principal Frederick Gibbard from 1942 was correspondingly reduced and the course truncated to 4 years. The small numbers of students, however, seems to have encouraged cross-communication and collaborative working. Indeed, a group of around 14 talented students, including Sir Philip Powell, Jacob Moyer of Powell and Moyer, June Mardell, Geoffrey Powell of Chamberlain Powell and Bond, and Neville Condor, scandalised the AA establishment by living communally, cohabiting in two rented houses, one of which was nicknamed Taliesin. Gibbard, however, did not last long as AA principal, and in late 1944, he resigned over the AA Council's doubts concerning his proposed scheme for the post-war school. Following a brief interim period with George Fairweather in charge, Raymond Gordon Brown, this gentleman here, a brisk, vigorous 32-year-old major from the Parachute Regiment, was appointed as the AA's first post-war principal. Something of a D-Day hero, he had planned and led an advanced airborne attack on a key German battery position. Brown was considered by the council as more than capable of sorting out a few rather unruly students. He was commissioned with the task of rebuilding the post-war AA school in Bedford Square. The school opened on 8th of January 1945, and by October, student numbers had swelled to a total of 325, not including the 100 GIs which attended a 9-week refresher course paid for by the US government. As servicemen and women were gradually decommissioned, student population increased still further, reaching an unprecedented 461 by January 47, 121 of which were women. For school leavers, entrance was once a year in September, but for those returning from the services, entry was permitted at any time. Officially, entrance was by interview, followed by examination in such subjects as drawing, general knowledge, science, maths, the sum of which amounted to a grand total of 11 hours. The application of this seems to have been somewhat flexible. Mr. Herbert Morell, who I think is here today, recalls how my interview with the AA principal professor, Gordon Brown, was almost a joke. I found him in the full uniform of a paratroop major, sitting in his office. All I had to show him was a rather bad copy I had made of a portrait by Rembrandt of an old man. Gordon Brown said, OK, young man, you're in. Looking at my subbies stripe. I said, isn't there an entrance examination? And he said, oh yes, but we only give it to people we don't want. In order to accommodate the increases in student numbers, the AA took over a bomb site on Tottenham Court Road, immediately behind the school, and on it erected a 40-foot Nissan hut with studio space for 120 students. This is rather fondly remembered by Mr. Alan Sewell, who again I think is here tonight. He remembers it as an uncomfortable, noisy building with electric overhead radiant heaters, which made our heads hot but left our feet freezing cold. Adjoining the Nissan hut were two smaller standard Ministry of Works huts containing a lecture hall and staff room. This diverse makeup of the newly enlarged student body appears to have fostered an extremely creative dynamic. School leavers were working alongside mature students, 10 years older than themselves, and who had gained considerable experience of leadership and teamwork, or indeed practical engineering and construction during the war. Students included such ranks as lieutenant colonels, majors, highly decorated marine commandos like Neil Munro, submarine lieutenants or bomber crews such as Bill Howell. For fourth year master David Goddard, the large numbers of mature students meant that work standards were incredibly high at the level of postgraduate projects, really. The AA retained its radical pre-war reputation, and a rather excited editorial in the AJ of December 11, 1947, whilst dismissing offhand the Liverpool and Cambridge schools of architecture, stated that the students and masters of the AA do in fact today represent the unquestionable seat and centre of avant-gardism in architecture for the whole country. They provide the intelligentsia of which architecture is so badly in need, and they carry out their responsibilities as a moral, intellectual, and aesthetic pressure group within the profession. Indeed, by 1947, it seemed that the 1930s battle against the Beaux-Arts curriculum was well and truly over. Gordon Brown was a card-carrying member of MARS, Modern Architecture Research Group, and as one of his first moves in 1945, invited fellow MARS member, communist Arthur Korn, to join the staff as head of planning. 1947, the year that MARS organised the first post-war CM conference at Bridgewater, at least 8 other AA staff were registered as card-carrying members. And here we have the famous photograph of the 1947 CM meeting taken at the Bristol aeroplane factory. You can see a good few AA faces here, as well as Corb on your left. We have Cadbury Brown, who's I think secondary left, and on the left. We have Serge Cadley, who is Director of Technical Studies, who's in the middle at the back of us, so I don't have a pointer here. Together with Leo De Silis and Anthony Cox, who are in the third and fourth, I think in the second row. Yes. Together with, I mean, so many AA alumni there, Jane Drew, J.M. Richards. It's perhaps worth noting that schools at the time still teaching pretty much arts and crafts or Beaux-Arts fashion. At the Bartlett, the Neo-Georgian Hector Corfiato had replaced Albert Richardson, whilst, as Nicholas Bullock has pointed out, at the Liverpool School and Regent Street Polytechnic, modernist teachers were still something of an exception rather than the rule. Now, I want to get my bit in about the student pantomime, but I'm not going to sing. student satire at the AA is generally a very accurate barometer of change within the school, and as an indicator of the school's current preoccupations, the 1947 centennial student pantomime performed in the Jarvis Hall of the RIBA is no exception. The rather torturous plot, courtesy of Ian Calhoun and James Dartford, traced the adventures of Acanthia Ann, symbolising the AA, and her courtship by, in turn, different styles in AA history. Prince Perpendicular of Dilettante, Prince Dorian of Corinthia, followed by Oscar and Norman, the sons of Arthur of Arts and Crafts, before being courted and won by the smooth-talking Prince Vanguard of Mars. The marriage of the AA and Mars thus being consummated. And here's a costume design by Charmian Lacey, who's here today as well. Please note the one of the unsuccessful rivals, Prince Vanguard, is a siren polytechnic. In other ways, educational philosophy and practice have changed somewhat at the AA. Town planning was now accepted as a more important aspect of education. Principal contributors to the Mars 1942 Plan for London, Arthur Korn and Felix Samueli, were on the staff. Indeed, the fifth year project for 1946-7 was a 300-acre site on the South Bank for a hypothetical international exhibition of 56. Supported by lectures given by representatives of the Ministry of Town and Country Planning and of Transport, together with members of the LCC, the principal aim of this project being to encourage planning in its widest and most imaginative sense. Many of the students involved in the battles of the 30s were now employed as staff. In 1947, a total of seven members of the Architects Co-Partnership, including influential figures such as Anthony Cox, Kenneth Capon, Michael Grice, Leo De Silis, were present as studio and technical staff. The importance of men such as these as teachers cannot be overemphasised. Leonard Manasseh, in an interview with Louise Brody in 1998, declares that Anthony Cox and his partners before, during and after the war were, in his opinion, largely responsible for the promotion and the seeding of the modern movement in this country. One of the other battles of the 30s, that for group working, had also been won. Group working formed a major part of the curriculum in the second and fourth and fifth years. Not all students, however, appreciated the process, and Arthur Lewis, MBE, writing to the archive, remembers how group working was then the thing, and how one student I remember, Patrick Horsburgh, refused. "You can't design a building with a committee." Later, he produced the project we were given on time, beautifully done, with a model, while we were still arguing. "There is Horsburgh on his lofty peak," said the year master. I think Horsburgh, incidentally, went on to become professor of architecture at Notre Dame University, Indiana, where he founded the discipline of environmental studies. According to David Goddard again, within the immediate post-war period of the AA, the whole problem of architectural teaching was being treated on a much more realistic level than ever before. And during this five-year period, the revolutionary concepts of the 30s were actually put in place. One symptom of this more realistic approach was an increasing preference amongst students for making models of their schemes. And where possible, all briefs given to the students were worked out in conjunction with real clients, and the projects produced were the result of a very close collaboration between staff, students, and clients. And this is something Mr. Oliver Cox might remember. To take just one example of these live projects, the fourth year students of 1946-47 were provided with a commission from Penguin Publishers for a site in West London. Alan Lane himself acted as the client, and his company architect visited and acted the role of critic to the students. The increased use of models by students can be seen in this photograph, taken for a special issue of AJ celebrating a day in the life of the AA in 1947. And also in the only known piece of film footage of the AA from the 40s. I'm afraid it's really tiny, so I'm too excited. It's really weird. Very slow down. I did warn you. There are other changes too. Gordon Brown had implemented a new practical training centre based next to the Nissan huts in the bomb site behind the AA. Here, over the course of their 5-year training, students gained practical experience in the techniques of bricklaying and masonry and in the construction of reinforced concrete slabs, followed by comprehensive programme including asphalting, floor finishing, plastering, timber framing, and roof covering. And each year, guided by visiting experts from various trade organisations, strange composite constructions were erected. Mr. Herbert Morell again remembers the practical training yard primarily as a launch pad for a series of tape and cardboard rockets constructed with homemade gunpowder, which targeted Oxford Street until a visit from the local Tottenham Court Road police. The AA student body of the immediate post-war years was an exceptionally well-organised, motivated, socially and politically aware. It included a very strong left-wing presence, and Mr. Chris Whittaker, in an interview with Kevin Morgan for the British Library Sound Archive in 2001, remembers the AA as a hotbed of communism, with at one point at least 16 party members. Indeed, for many, Gordon Brown's changes did not go nearly far enough in addressing the needs of post-war architectural education. And on the concluding day of the AA centennial celebrations, the Students' Education Subcommittee organised an international symposium and discussion on the subject, with student representatives attending from as far afield as Palestine, Czechoslovakia, Austria, Denmark, Sweden. The AA's links with the UK National Architecture Student Body, the Architectural Students Association, or ARCH-SA, was also strong at this point. AA students had joined in 1944 and registered Mount House, behind the backs of the council, as the headquarters of the Southern Section. And in April 1947, an AA delegation of 14 attended the ARCH-SA Brighton Congress on Architectural Education, and subsequently the editorship of PLAN, Student Association's journal, moved to Bedford Square, resulting in the production of a celebrated run of issues between 1948 and 51. And here we have a photograph on the right of the PLAN editorial board as it stood in late 1947. When the AJ's photographer visited. I think it's left from left to right, and please do correct me if I'm wrong. Sam Scorer, T. Williams, N. Hyams, and I think you can just see a little bit of Graham Shanklin towards the bottom there. Issue 1 of 1948 was to feature this remarkable illustration from the wonderful pen of Mr. Oliver Cox again. Features barricades in Bedford Square, students hanging out of the windows and from the trees, student marches with placards such as abolish fees and principals without principles. Significantly, the second issue of PLAN was dedicated to architectural education, its editorial urging that this urgent desire to improve our training is part of the task of rebuilding our land, for it is clear that if the future architect is to be equipped to play his vital role, he must have a complete understanding of his work and his responsibilities. Group working was also featured in Plan 2, with Michael Ventris documenting a symposium on the subject, starring alongside AA students, Stuart Johnson Marshall, of course the man responsible for the remarkable house building, a school building programme in Hertfordshire, together with Carl Koch, then a professor at MIT. Alongside its preoccupation with student education, PLAN also reflected current attitudes to architectural theory and practice. Le Corbusier's Modulor was reviewed in PLAN 8 by a young Joseph Rykwert, while Stephen McFarlane, one of the many AA students who made a pilgrimage to France to see the Unité d'Habitation under construction, recorded his impressions and analysis of the building in issue 4 of 1949. In issue 7, was to feature a clever little sketch by Pat Crook, which Corb was to return a compliment in 1955 in his Modulor 2, where he described the PLAN group as charming young men, sincere and passionate friends. They respect the Modulor. What is more, they have wit. like ducks shaking their feathers as they come out of the water. They have published, with the names of the members of their committee, this picture of a topsy-turvy modular man, which is not without savour. Which brings us, in conclusion, to Le Corbusier's reception within this rather heady AA atmosphere of 1947. For the official AA centennial celebrations, a set of distinguished delegates had been invited by the council from 11 countries, including, of course, France, represented by Pierre Vago, Albert Lacroix, and Auguste Perret. The students' coup in getting Le Corbusier to accept their invitation and talk to them was therefore represented in the builder in terms of something of a triumph against the AA establishment. Not least in locating Le Corbusier, but second, to persuade him to visit London, the more so, as it is rumoured that more august approaches had failed. The students did it by cheating, of course. They adopted the simple but direct process of buying an airplane passage and conveying it to Paris by a courier. Corbusier was undoubtedly something of an icon to students. Professor Dennis Hinton recalled how, on his entry to the AA in 1946, direct from school, he had never heard of Le Corbusier, but soon discovered that his name was on everybody's lips, more than that of any contemporary architect, the possible exception of Frank Lloyd Wright. And in a rather wonderful description, one alumni present at the lecture describes his impression of Corbusier with his rock-like head and orb owl glasses as resembling an Easter Island god. However, despite the incredible influence that Corbusier's ideas was to have upon that generation, uncritical hero worship does not seem to have sat happily with such a mature, independent, and free-thinking student body. And indeed, I hope this symposium and the discussion period allotted afterwards will allow participants and alumni here to draw out in greater detail their individual recollections and impressions of his visit and the implications of it. Thank you very much.
There's coffee and tea in the room where your coats are. We're going to restart at 2:45. So you probably have to get your skates on, unfortunately. But you'll hear me bellowing when we're ready to start again.
You were a conversation around that.
I read part of the thesis.
Yes.
Connor, as you know, was notoriously reluctant to actually complete any piece of written work.
Yeah.
So I did it for him.
Okay. Let's have a coffee.
I need another coffee.